Thank you, Taylor. That was very nice. This is Taylor's last Sabbath with us for this school year. She's attending Missouri Southern State University. She is a lion and always will be a lion. But she's just going for the summer, and she'll be back in August to be a senior?
Yeah.
You mean yes? That's all right. Finishing is what counts. We're gonna miss her for the summer, and we've enjoyed having her here. It's been nice. Okay. Last Sunday, eating breakfast, and got Michael and Kathy, Neil somewhere, and we have the computer on the counter, and we got YouTube going, and here's this guy in a red polo shirt, and he is an Iron Man. And he is talking about what it is like to be an Iron Man and what it is like to prepare for an Iron Man. And we're eating breakfast. Now, I'm not really that interested in Iron Man per se, but my son is. And so I'm kind of listening in to this experience. And then this guy finishes talking, and now another one comes up. And this guy's talking about what it's like to be an Iron Man. And he seemed a little more not as professional in this approach, but because as he was going through his Iron Man experience, and for those of you on, I'm going to get this wrong, but we're going to just round this off. It's about a 2-mile swim, if that's not enough. Then you ride the bike for 112, 116 miles, somewhere like that, and then if you don't feel like that's enough, you finish it off with a marathon. And they give you about 12 hours before they close the course. You can finish, but you get no medal if you finish after that. So here's this guy talking about his Ironman experience. And on mile 17 of the marathon portion, he's describing how his muscles are cramping up and he's in some real pain. Now, I don't know how his daughter is with him, per se, but apparently he has stopped. And he's got 9 miles to go. And for those of us who don't know anything about this, there's a lot of training involved to be able to even do it. So there's months of preparation, maybe even years, getting ready. And so he's on mile 17, and he doesn't think he's going to finish. So his daughter says, but Dad, your arms are still good. Your arms don't hurt. You could do cartwheels. And he finishes the race, cartwheeling to some level. And maybe his muscles got a little better, maybe not, I don't know. But the fat point is that he finished the race. So that's what we do at breakfast on Sunday morning. So 9 miles of cartwheels, or something along that nature. So I'm sitting there and I'm watching these guys talk and I'm thinking, you know, they've got views because you go to YouTube, you can see how many people have looked at it. And there were probably people in the audience. And I'm thinking, this is like church for these people. You know, because they're listening to someone explain how to do something that they desire to do. And I thought, that's sort of like church. It's almost like the Christian. But then I thought, well, no. The Christian is not going to get up and tell you, look what I have done, you try to be like it. The Christian will not do that. So what I think for the Christian is we will have to wait for heaven before we can make our YouTube video. Because then we can say what it was like to make it. But in the meantime, we're still going to have church, and we're still going to talk about how to get there. So before we open the Word of God, let's pray for a moment. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for this Sabbath day. And Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit will guide us just now to teach us and to lead us in the way that we are to go. Father, may the message come together in the way that would bring honor and glory to your name. May we be blessed and refreshed from having worshiped you on this Sabbath day. And so we ask these things, and for your will to be done above all things. Amen. A few weeks ago, we went camping. Some of you in the audience were there. It was a very nice weekend. And the one thing about camping, especially when it's nice weather, it affords a kind of a time to get out and maybe have your devotional time in a little different setting than maybe the couch, maybe your bed, your easy chair, whatever, wherever you may have that devotional. It's just kind of nice to get out. And this was an Easter weekend, and so I was just kind of thinking on, and it's not Easter in the sense of it was that same day and weekend that Christ died and all, but as the world knows it. And so I was just kind of reflecting on that, the life and crucifixion of Christ, and I turned to Daniel 9:26, and we're going to read part of that verse as just kind of a starting point. So in Daniel 9:26, it says, "And after 62 weeks shall Messiah," now Messiah is capital M, "shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself." Well, the Messiah would be cut off. You know, what does that mean, to be cut off? We may have heard, whether jokingly or maybe real, you hear of the phrase, "Well, I've been cut out of the will." Or maybe a parent will say to their child, "Well, if you keep acting like that, I'm going to cut you out of the will. Or I'm going to take you out of the will." Well, that's a form of being cut off. Well, that just means that whatever material possessions that person may have, you're not going to get any, is what that would mean. But as this phrase "cut off" relates to the Messiah, it means that to the Jews at that time, it meant that the Messiah was not going to come as they expected. They were expecting Jesus, the Messiah, to come as a conqueror, an emancipator, and instead, the Bible tells us that the Messiah would meet a violent death, quite opposite of their expectation. In fact, we are told in the Desire of Ages somewhere that the Jews applied the prophecy of the second coming, which is the kingdom of glory that we too expect to see, they applied the prophecies to that second coming. So they took the prophecies that relate to Christ's first coming and they applied them to the second coming. So when Jesus showed up as a carpenter, no real money, maybe not even looks to draw, it didn't fit their mold, so they rejected him. "You're supposed to come as an emancipator. You're going to deliver us from the Roman army. You're going to set up a king. We'll be in charge and not someone charge over us." But Jesus didn't come that way. They weren't expecting him to come that way. And when he did come, they rejected him. So the Messiah would be cut off. That means he would die for our sins. He would. And so right there in the prophetic, that 2,300 days, the 490 more specifically in this, you know, the gospel is presented to us that Jesus would die for the sins of the world. And that was kind of my thinking on that Sabbath morning as I was just kind of reading these verses. But there's another phrase that comes after this that's even more profound. And it says, "but not for himself." So Messiah will die, but he's not going to do it for himself. In the margin, it means, "and shall have nothing." Nothing. Do you know what it is to have nothing? Now, I can't say that I've felt that way totally. No, I have felt that way, but I can't say that it's ever been that totally true. I remember a day when I was somewhere in college at Southwestern. I don't know, freshman, sophomore, seniors, one of those 4 years. And it was a Sabbath afternoon, and the Sabbath was kind of drawing to a close, and I was thinking, like, Saturday night, whoa, let's go do something. And I'm thinking, well, okay, do something. I don't know what. I was just in my room by myself, so I don't know what was going on in my head, like if I was going to go with somebody or whatever. Didn't have a date, which wasn't always the thing, but it happened that day. And so I thought, well, if I'm going to do something, I might need money. So I get my wallet out, and I open it. There was nothing in it, not $1. I'm like, and for the first time in my life, I felt like I'm poor. I don't have any money. And I never felt poor in my life. I don't know, I'm 20, 21 years old, somewhere in there. And it's not like we grew up with a lot of money. We had some money, but we didn't have a lot of money. I mean, people were driving better cars than me, living in better houses than me, and wearing better clothes than me. But I never felt poor. To that Sabbath afternoon when I looked in my wallet and I had no money in it. But then I realized, oh, yeah, I got some money in Keene First Aid Bank, maybe. Oh, yeah, that's for tuition. Then I realized, well, okay, I got some money, but, oh, I can't spend that money. So I don't know what happened that Saturday night, but I just remember feeling poor, like I didn't have anything. And I'd never really felt like that in a long time. Now, today, it's not unusual for my wallet to be empty. But I don't feel poor because I have a credit card. And my credit card, one of them, has a higher credit limit than the company I work for. By design is why our company has a little lower limit. But anyway, now, to have nothing. A few weeks ago, we were eating lunch here at the church. The phone rang, and I answered it. And there was an individual on the other end of the line, and it was a lady, and she was looking for some help. And she said something that really kind of caught my ears and my attention. I have no one to help me. No one to help me. I thought, wow. I don't think I've ever been in a situation where I felt like no one to help me. And she's talking to me. Now, so I said, are you hungry? She said, yeah. I said, well, we're having lunch. She said, I'll be there in about 5 minutes. I said, okay. Well, I thought it would just be her, but there was like four or five of them. But that was fun. And then through some conversation and so forth, and then later on, we went to Walmart and we got some things. But that phrase, I have no one to help me. No one to help me. That kind of stuck with me. The Bible says, and shall have nothing. We're talking about the Messiah here. Now the text reads, also, in literal English, but not for himself. So if Christ, the Messiah, died for our sins, and the Bible says he didn't do it for himself, then it kind of makes us wonder, who did he do it for? Because that's a lot to go through. If there's nothing in it for me, really? But he did it anyway. So I was thinking about what would it be like if the world, and more so, let's just think individually, if our life could be emptied of all self. Self is totally gone. No more selfish motives. No more ulterior motives. Everything we do is selfless. So 24/7, 365, we live for the benefit of others and not my benefit or some ulterior motive like, well, if I do this, you'll do this. You know, there's something in it for me. I mean, all self is gone. What would that be like? Now, for those that have been mothers and are mothers, y'all probably may come the closest to what this is like, to live 100% benefit for someone else. Mothers probably get the prize on this. In fact, Mother's Day is next week. So this is the month of mothers. So they probably know what it's like, more so than maybe anyone. And the rest of us, men especially, we may move in and out, and maybe it's just me, move in and out of this state, just depending on how things are going. Now, I remember the day that I got married, I remember the year that I got married, but I do admit I sometimes forget how long it has been married. But you know what? Heaven is for eternity, right? So there is no time. So there you go. That's what marriage is like to the woman that I'm married to. It's like eternity. It's heaven. So for 28 years, I think that's it, right? 28, I'm thinking, if I got the math. Is that? No, July is 28. No, whatever. As long as we've been married that long, I don't think I can actually say that all 28 years, every day of that day that I have awakened with, I'm going to live 100% for the benefit of that woman that God gave me. I don't think I can say that. Now, I promised to do that, but I don't think I've done it. So there was a particular Sabbath that was our anniversary, and we were married in July 3, to be exact, and I do not recommend being married on that day. July 3, I would recommend not being married on any holiday or near any holiday because it's terrible trying to book something around that holiday. So do something off, you know. So the only thing that was great about it was we went to Jamaica, although I would have gone somewhere different, and it was the off season. And the rates were cheaper. So that made it okay. But I didn't realize why the rates were cheaper till we got down there. It's hurricane season. I'm like, oh my. Lord, please don't let one come during these 7 days. You know, I should have done some more research. But anyway, one Sabbath, I thought, can't go out to eat. Not going to really spend any money today. What can I do for our anniversary that would be something different that doesn't cost money? And it's not because it wasn't cheap, per se, and you know I am. But it wasn't. That was not the motivating factor. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to live 100% for her benefit over mine. So anything during the day, it's her first and me third, fourth, somewhere down the road. So that day was more like, anything she wanted, I did it. I cooked, I cleaned, I washed the dishes. She needed her feet rubbed, I made the bed. She wanted a drink of water, I got up and got it. Whatever she asked for, I did it. Didn't have to lift a finger. Now, when the day was over, I was tired. It's exhausting. Now, it was a peaceful sleep because I was worn out. But I haven't had a day like that since. I mean 100%. I mean 100%. I mean all in. But I had to ignore everything else to do that. So it's not like God can do that and keep all the planets in line. I couldn't do that. I couldn't take care of my wife and keep the planets in line. But God is God. But there was no, as far as I could tell, no selfishness involved in that day. We need another day like that, Kathy. Now let's go to John chapter 6. Anytime, right? Right, exactly. That's what I'm thinking. You just got to get your head around it. That's what I got to do. So let's go to John chapter 6. And for those of you that were in prayer meeting, this will be a little bit of a review. But for most of us, it'll be like the first time. So in John chapter 6, verse 6, and in this short reading here that we're only going to get one verse, Jesus is opening, he's about to feed the 5,000. Okay? And this is what we covered, part of what we covered in prayer meeting. But in John chapter 6, verse 6, that it says, and this he said to prove him. Now he's talking about Philip. For he himself knew what he would do. So here are the people. Jesus and his disciples are kind of wandering or running there out. They're out there coming down from the mountain. People are following him. And there's a crowd gathering. And Jesus is seeing the crowd. And apparently Jesus knows what he's going to do. Because in verse 5, he's asking Philip, basically, where can we go to get to buy food? Because you see, Philip was from that area. And he knew where the restaurants were. I'm sure Jesus knew them too, but he was asking because it says he wanted to test him. So he's asking Philip, you know, where can we go? But even more specifically, he was like asking Philip, how are we going to do this? How are we going to feed all these people? Because there's a bunch. 5,000 at least men, and then you got women on top of that. So, and this is a quote coming out of the SDA Bible Commentary on page 960. And this is, it's an interesting comment that the commentary brings out. Because it says, this confidence grew out of his complete faith in the power of his Father to supply the needs of those for whom he would soon make request. So Jesus knew what he would want to do. He hasn't even asked the Father if he would even answer the prayer yet. But he knew that his Father would answer the prayer before he even asked. That's what it's saying here. Now, this is why he could do that. And this is what's critical. This faith, in turn, was the result of complete communion between the Father and the Son. And this is the this next sentence is what really caught my attention. This is why God could do this, or why Jesus could do this. No sin. Now, we can't say that we have no sin. We have sinned. Now, Jesus could say that. There was no sin in him. But by God's grace, we could get this. No sin or self-seeking stood in the way to obstruct the full flow of the Father's power through his incarnate Son. No self-seeking stood in the way. We obstruct God by our self-seeking. God cannot work through us to the full capacity because self is somewhere weaved into that possibly good thing that we're trying to do. You remember the disciples. They said, Lord, let us call fire down from heaven so that we can consume those people over there because they're not with us. They're trying to be like us, but they're not with us. And Jesus said, well, you don't even know the spirit in which you asked for. Because if he gave them that power, they would have called fire down from heaven, but it would have not been in God's will for that to have been done. So they were asking for things, but there was selfish motivation behind it. So God can't work. Because it says right here, no sin or self-seeking stood in the way to obstruct the full flow of the Father's power through his incarnate Son. So if we're going to see the full power of God working through us, self is going to have to be laid to rest. It cannot be involved in any of our thought process. What's in it for me? Or if I do this, I will get something. No self-seeking stood in the way. Only thus could Jesus work among men with full assurance of being able to meet whatsoever situation might arise and to fulfill whatever human needs might be presented to him. No self-seeking, no sin stood in the way. Now, let's bring it down to our level a little bit. Sometimes we don't get along with people. Sometimes people don't get along with us. Sometimes people say something to us that hurts our feelings. There may be times when somebody does something and now we are offended. So, when that happens, usually, in many cases, we become absorbed in how the situation has affected us. And this can go so far as to, we now will not talk to that person because of what has happened. And I'm not trying to judge right or wrong. It just means this is what happens. It's what sometimes happens to me. Don't want to talk to them because whether it's real or not, they've hurt me. My feelings are hurt. They've offended me. So we cannot talk to them. We will not approach them. And if we do approach them, we may say something we should not have said. Or we may regret it later. Now, can God work? No. He can't work through that. Because we're holding on to something. He can't work. We're bound. We're not able to go and talk to that person in a Christ-like way. Because we can't get past our own thought process, our own feelings. So we can't. So, you know, it doesn't mean that if we were somehow to figure out how to surrender all self, it doesn't necessarily mean that we may be feeding 5,000 people. But it could mean that. It's possible. Because Jesus did say that greater works than these shall they perform. And he was talking about the last day. The gospel, or the end of the age, is going to not end on a small display of God's power. It's going to end on a very grand display of God's power. And he's going to live that power, or shine forth through what we would know as the 144,000. And that's going to be a group of people who have learned, by God's grace, to have no self-seeking in their life. And God will be able to use them to go forth and give the loud cry message to prepare a world to meet the second coming. There's not going to be any self-seeking in that group. So when we allow self to die in today's environment, today, right now, we may be able to find it that we can approach that brother or sister that we feel has offended us or hurt us or done something we have not liked to us. Now, the devil would have us to believe that being bound like that is liberating, but that's true freedom. Harboring ill feelings towards someone else, that is liberating. Now, the devil would like for us to believe that's freedom, but that's a deception. Because true freedom would allow us to go talk to that individual in the spirit of Christ. That's what true freedom would allow the Christian to do. But the devil would have us believe the opposite. And that's tricky. We have to keep those things in mind. Now, if you were in Daniel 9:26 and you were following the margin, how are we doing there? It would direct you to Mark chapter 9. And let's go there. Mark chapter 9, another gospel. Oh man, I don't know what I'm thinking. And Jesus is talking to his disciples in verse 11 and 12. So Mark 9, verse 11 and 12. And they asked him, saying, "Why say the scribes that Elias must first come?" And he answered and told them, "Elias verily cometh first and restoreth all things, and how it is written of the Son of Man that he must suffer many things and be set at naught." Okay. So that particular Sabbath morning, which is a way that I like to kind of study the Bible at times, is just read a verse and then see what another verse connects. And this was connecting to Mark 9, 11 and 12. And as I was reading 11 and 12, the thing that kind of stuck out to me was, this is Jesus talking, and he's telling his disciples how it is written of the Son of Man. And if you go to the margin on that text, Daniel 9, 26 is listed. There's also three other texts that are listed, because it's talking about how the Son of Man would suffer. But what I think what struck me that morning as I was reading is, this is Jesus talking, and he is drawing the attention of his disciples back to the Word of God. You know, sometimes we as parents, maybe even sometimes we as bosses, just do it and trust me. Have you ever heard that phrase? Trust me on this. Well, I don't trust hardly anybody. So I like, to me, you're going to have to prove it to some level. And then I'm not from Missouri per se, but... And I guess maybe that's Missouri, the show me state. So maybe we're not a very trusting people here. But you've heard people say, well, just trust me on this one. But Jesus didn't do that. He said, it is written. Like, go and look at the scriptures that have been available to you all these years. Go and look at those scriptures and see what they say. And that struck out to me. Because Jesus was the inspiration of the Old Testament. But he didn't pull rank. He didn't pull any authority. He just said, go look and see what it says. So, in all four of those verses talk about the sufferings of Christ. Now, in Matthew 28, 1 to 6, and this is actually where we get the sermon title, which really has not much to do with the sermon. I just thought it was an interesting point in our Christian faith in Matthew 28, 1 through 6. It says here that in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was, or had been, a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, "Fear not, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen." And here's what another thing that caught my eye. As he has said. Even the angel is referring back to... Jesus referred back to the scriptures of the Old Testament. The angel is referring back to the word of Jesus. They're saying, look what he said, and look what you see today. Look what Christ said, and look what you see. Now, there's a short, I think, and it could be developed, but man had put the stone in front of the sepulcher. So, you got some bad habits? Man did that. God did not create bad habits. Man has created bad habits. Fault of character, what have you, those come from our carnal nature. God did not create that. So we have rolled a stone over our bad habits and our faulty character. We have placed a stone. Now, there's a reason we place that stone over it. Because we don't want God to get to it. Because you see, the angel came down and he removed the stone that man had placed. And it's to say, okay, look, you put it there. I'm going to make sure it doesn't go back. So the angel, you sit on it so that no one will pick it up and put it back. So the angel sat on the stone. So in our life, the carnal nature puts the stone over the tomb. The angel comes, or the Holy Spirit. will come and help us get that victory, to roll the stone away, and by a continual moment-by-moment surrender, we can make sure that stone never gets picked up again. The angel can sit on it. See, that's what came to me that morning as I was thinking about that. But anyway, going on. The angel is referring to, as he said. So the angel is referring back to what God has said. So, now this is not an unusual occurrence in the Bible. We have Matthew chapter 4 in the temptations. Jesus three times said, "It is written." He referred to the scriptures. And then in Luke 24, on the road to Emmaus, Christ recounted the scriptures in Moses, the law, the Psalms, the prophets, on down, so that he could show them that what the scripture said is what they saw happen and the fulfillment. And that was even before he revealed himself to us. And so the first evidence of the Word of God doing what it says it will do is in Genesis chapter 1. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And so this is probably why so many of our seminars of evangelism, we start out in Daniel chapter 2. It is to build a foundation of God's Word and to show the historical validity that what God said happened. So now, on the very first night of an evangelistic series, we get an introduction to God who does what he says, and what he says comes to fulfillment. Why would you not want to trust a God like that? Because you don't see that in the world. They say this and this happens. Yeah, sometimes, maybe, but not always. But God says it happens. And so we can have confidence as that. Now, this is the part where I kind of struggled a little bit, because I thought, well, if it is as simple as reading the Word of God, believing that, well, God said it, it must going to happen, okay, great, then why aren't there more of us doing it? And I think one thing that kind of caught my eye is, and maybe because I'm getting older, I know I am, is it seems like as we get older, we should become more saintly because we've had more time to study. That's not always the case, the saintly part. We are getting older, but we don't always become more saintly. So I'm a bit of a process guy. I like steps, step one, step two, and I get very irritated when we don't follow that, especially when it comes to spending money. Oh, I hate spending money without approval. Oh, my. Those of you that know me on the church board, I'm just as bad at work. Probably worse. Well, I don't know about worse. But about the same. I mean, it's not that I don't think the expenditure is bad. I don't like the way it was done. I don't like the process. There's a set way. You can spend so much money. You have a $200 limit. That's all you can spend. And that's not even you can spend it, because you got to remember, you can't approve your own expenditure. Yeah, think about that. I want a new chair in my office. You're going to have to find someone to allow you to do that, because you cannot fill out a rec and turn it in and someone's going to buy you a new chair. It's not going to happen. That expenditure's got to get approved by someone other than you, because you can't approve your own expenditure. Yeah, it could be hard living with me. When it comes to money. But you will not want for what you need. You will not be broke. So, now, and I like process. It's probably one of the things of accounting that drew me to accounting after I flunked my chemistry test. Because my dad said I should be a doctor. And I'm like, oh, sure, fine. That's fine. I'll be a doctor. But that chemistry didn't go well. And I thought I would like chemistry, but I realized I didn't like it. And after 3 weeks of that, I'm like, I really about failed. I say I did fail it. I mean, it was low enough grade. I realized, oh man. So I switched to accounting, and it's been good. I've liked it, and I caught up, because I thought, you know, accounting, they have rules. You can read those rules, and you apply them. And I thought, well, I can do that. I can read, and I can do it. And so it's been good in accounting. So as I was reading there that Sabbath and Sunday morning, and I thought, it is written, it is written. Yeah, man, if it was that easy, where's the victory that should be coming from this? If it was that easy, just to read and do, read and do, read and do. Where is it? It's not happening, or not happening to the level that it seems like it should. So I thought, well, maybe there's something in the 10 virgins, maybe the wise and foolish virgin parable. And thought maybe there's something there. And then I read that and I thought, well, no, I don't think there is. Didn't seem too much. But now I'm going to come back to it because I think there is something in there. Now, in Christ Object Lessons, it says that for a time. Now, you don't know. We're going to know it right now. That the wise and foolish versions depict the two classes of people who will be alive when Jesus comes the second time. Okay? So we are in either one of them, those classes, right now. But it says that in Christ Object Lessons, that for a time, the two groups run side by side, and you can't tell a difference. Five are wise, five are foolish, but when you put the 10 of them together in a group, can't tell a difference. They all look the same. But five are wise and five are foolish, but you can't tell a difference because they're running really close. Because they're acting alike. They're talking alike. They're believing alike. They're attending alike. When the church is open, they're showing up kind of thing. There's a lot of similarities in their lifestyle and what they believe and what they think. But Christ Object Lessons goes on and says, it is in a time of crisis that character is revealed. She makes an interesting observation. Both parties, both the wise and the foolish, both parties are taken unaware. Something has happened to both of them, the event that neither one truly anticipated. It did not happen the way I was thinking it would happen. Sound like the Jews of old? It didn't happen the way they thought. They rejected. Both parties are taken unawares. But there's a difference. Even though both are taken unawares, one party was prepared for the emergency, and the other was found wanting. Now, if you were on that camp out, back in April. It was a beautiful Friday, a marvelous Sabbath, and Sunday morning, it rained. And it rained pretty good. Now, I knew it was going to rain. We know that Jesus is coming the second time. I knew it was going to rain. If you know it's going to rain, what are you going to do? You're going to pack a raincoat, eh? Or you might. But if you do what I did, I don't need a raincoat. So when it rains, I'm not prepared. And Neil and Corey and I are out mountain biking, and they're younger, and I'm slower in the hills. And I said, you guys just go ahead. Because I saw some lightning off. I said, it's probably going to rain. But I already knew it was going to rain. But y'all go, get back to the camp, get the truck, come back and get me. So off they go. And they're off there. But I was going down the one side of the river, and it was a little steep on that one side, so I thought, well, I better look over there just in case maybe they fall off. But they had not fallen off, and fortunately, I did not fall off looking for them to fall off. So we're pedaling, and we're getting back, and By about the time I get to campground A, it's, you know, it had been sprinkling lightly, then it's really starting to come down. So I go find the bathroom, and I'm got shelter, and I'm thinking, I wonder if they're going to come back. Because it's raining pretty hard, and I'm thinking, it's a little uphill, I'll just stay right here. Well, they did come back. Corey came and got me. And we got back to camp, and a little bit later, of course, we had packed up most of our stuff by then, so it was all dry, but Michael had brought a raincoat. He was prepared, but he was leaving to go home, so I said, Michael, may I have your raincoat? Because Kathy and I wanted to go on a hike, and it was probably going to rain a little more, and we wanted to see these falls that Michelle had told us about, and we thought, man, we'll see some water falling. It'd be cool. And now, that might work on that day to borrow someone else's raincoat. But in this time of crisis, because character is what's involved here, the development of character, this cannot be transferred. We cannot come to the last day there and say, oh, you've got a relationship with Jesus. Can I get some of that from you? Do you have a little bit you could just somehow spoon it in, maybe? I don't know how it's, could we just hook up, maybe get some of your blood into my blood? I don't know how that, you cannot transfer character in that day. So when the foolish virgins were asking for oil from the wise virgins, and the wise virgins said, no, we don't have any more. We've just put it all in. Basically, God is telling us, character development is not transferable. We may be able to borrow a raincoat someday, maybe an umbrella, but in this day in which we live, we cannot borrow someone else's character. Oh, they're a godly saint. I wish I could be like them. That's not going to save us. They can talk to you and explain it to you all day long, but until we take it in and allow God to do that work in us that he desires to do, it's an individual matter. It's not going to be able to be transferred. We're not going to be able to hold on to someone else while they're being taken into the kingdom. We will have to enter because of what God has done to us on an individual basis. Now, what I found interesting, also coming out of Christ's Object Lessons, is that the class represented by the foolish virgins are not hypocrites. Now, what's a hypocrite? They say one thing and do another. These people are not hypocrites. They're foolish, but they're not hypocrites. They regard the truth. They advocated the truth. They are attracted to those who believe the truth. But here's the difference between the foolish and the wise. The foolish virgins have not yielded themselves to the working of the Holy Spirit. And that is the difference. They have not fallen upon the rock, Jesus Christ, and permitted their old nature to be broken up. She goes on to say that these folks, the foolish virgins, they're content with a superficial work. Oh, that's getting a little close. I don't want to change that habit. I'll change a little, but not all the way. Just tweak it a little, but not full. Superficial. And in the end, they will show that they really don't know God, is what the foolish virgins will say. This is why it is written is very important. We need it. But it's why it's not totally just enough. Because it says that without the Spirit of God, knowledge of his word is of no avail. So to know the theory, while that may be good, the Holy Spirit is needed to quicken and sanctify the heart. And in our last text and closing, in John 4:24, you know, Jesus kind of sums this whole thing up and says that in John 4:24, it says, we must worship God in spirit and truth. We have to put both of them together. Not just the letter of the law, but we need the spirit of the law as well. And so our thought this morning, at least as I was having them there those couple of days, is, you know, self needs to die and allow the Holy Spirit to make the Word of God real to us and not just a letter. Because the letter's kind of harsh. I do enough lettering at work. You didn't do this? Okay, fine. Well, you're in trouble. You know, versus a little more spirit. It's not that we don't have some spirit, but we need the Spirit of God to work in us so that the Word of God and the Spirit of God working together, it will perfect our character so that we are able to stand in that last day. And so when the crisis is revealed to us, for which we knew was coming, but yet somewhat unprepared, we will have that Holy Spirit dwelling within us that will help us to overcome, and we won't be found wanting. And we'll be able to join that procession as those wise virgins did and not have to go to town and buy something, and by the time we get back, the door's closed. You know, we'll be in sync with God because we've been following Him. To be in sync with God is really just to follow His Spirit, His Holy Spirit. So as the Holy Spirit impresses upon us to do something, and we yield and we do it, we become in communion with Him. And the closer and the more we do it, the more communion we have and the closer we get. And eventually, if it's God's desire, He will have us proclaim the loud cry message because self will be totally gone. Think about what self, all no self, no self. That's deep. But anyway, we're going to sing our closing song right now.
Let's all stand as we sing 554, Oh Let Me Walk With Thee. Let's all stand, please.
I cannot dare.
Dear Father, this morning we pray, dear Lord, there's nothing more than what you want to do is to bring us home to you. We desire that, but our nature, help our unbelief, dear Lord. It seems impossible, but we know that with you all things are possible. Help our mindset, help our thinking to become one with you and be right with you. And so, Father, we pray that you will never leave us nor forsake us until you bring us home to that one day when we can live eternally together. We ask these things.